Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our live stream on this wonderful Sunday morning. Today we are online only. We had to cancel our in-person service today because of the impending storm. Our governor declared a state of emergency here in New York for Long Island and the five boroughs. And out of an abundance of caution, and of course we care for the safety of our people, New York streets are noted for floodings, and we want to make sure people are safe. And we are so grateful for this opportunity to be able to come online and still have service in spite of the building itself being closed. Amen. So it's good to be here. I want us to go before the Lord in prayer. Let's thank the Lord for keeping us, for always protecting us, and bringing us again together safely through this entire week. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Mighty God, we are so grateful for your loving kindness, which is better than life. We are thankful for the people, God, that you have given to us, and for, Lord God, this wonderful opportunity to share the gospel, not only in New York, God, but wherever we may be, God, across the United States of America and this world. We are so grateful for the love of Christ. Thank you for dying on the cross for us. And today, God, we pray that in spite of the rain outside, that we will rejoice and be glad in this wonderful day that you have made. And we're asking you, God, to anoint your people. Lord, send blessings, God, into each and every home. And we pray, mighty God, that, Lord, you would allow healing to flow, God. Those who are sick and afflicted, God, those that we've been praying for, we ask you, God, to honor our prayers as we pray together corporately for one another. And we will give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen.
Giving is an important part of what we do here.
It allows us to fulfill our mission by reaching people through our local and online ministry.
Did you know that when you give to New Life, you're not just giving to the local ministry?
You are also sharing the love of Jesus with people all over the world.
Along with our global partners, we're providing natural and spiritual needs to people in places like South America, Africa, the Caribbean, and more.
With your help, we can truly fulfill our mission, changing lives through the gospel of Jesus Christ.
If you would like to join us in giving, there are three ways to give.
You can text any dollar amount to 84321.
Go to our website, mynewlifenyc.org.
Or you can give in person at the end of the service. Thank you for giving to New Life.
Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's put our hands together.
I will not die.
Come on, let's bless the Lord in this place. Come on. I know that my God is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. And I know what he's done for them back then, he can do it again. Amen? No matter what it is, no problem, no situation is too hard for my God. And he has proven himself over and over again. Amen? Hallelujah. Come on and lift up your hands and worship him. Come on, his presence is here. Let's praise him and acknowledge him. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, we worship you. We honor you and we adore you, Jesus. Walking around these walls, I know by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me, yeah. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me, yeah. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. See, Jesus, you're still, yeah.
Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise.
I see you move.
You move the
I've seen him move. I've seen him move mountains. Can you say with all certainty today that you have seen him move, that you do believe that he's a God that is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness? I want you to know that he's lighting up the kingdom, and this kingdom cannot be shaken. How is your walk with God today? Today we want to go to the Word of God, and we want to look at our steps with him. Thank you so much for joining us today. Again, we're so sorry that we couldn't be in the church building just worshiping the Lord. I'm missing that, but we also need to be wise, and out of an abundance of caution, I made the decision to cancel the in-person service today. But you know what? We can still worship the Lord, and I know you just enjoyed the singing from the praise and worship team. And today we want to go to the Word of God, and we want to look at steps with him. And today we are looking at the subtitle, A Walk with God. I've often thought a little bit about how we perceive ourselves as Christians and how we're looking at ourselves in this society, not just the United States of America, but worldwide, and how Christianity is perceived, and how sometimes we want to water down the Word of God, water down our walk with God, our commitment to God. And that's what this series is all about. If we want to walk with Him, then we've got to walk with Him the way He wants us to walk with Him. Is that right? And so today we want to go to the Word of the Lord, Amos chapter 3, and we're going to read verse 3 and verse 7, just to bring some context to this particular subject today. Do two walk together unless they have agreed to do so? Surely the sovereign Lord does nothing without revealing His plan to His servants, the prophets. Amen. Mighty God, we pray that You would bless the word. Lord, we pray for the anointing of God, not only on the preacher, God, but on Your people. We want our minds to be ready to receive, our hearts, Lord God, softened up, so that when we are convicted, we will say yes to Your will and to Your way. We love You. We thank You, God, for all those that have joined and those who will be listening and joining later. We pray, God, that the Word of God will go forth with power and authority. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. Jesus once said to His disciples, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command. Love each other. Now, Jesus is calling His disciples to give them an invitation to walk with Him, to follow after Him. And every time Jesus did this, it would strike a chord in my heart and in my spirit, because there were times when these men were very busy. They were working. But when Jesus said, come, follow me, they would literally drop everything that they were doing to follow Him. Isn't that so different from today's society, that the Lord has been calling some people for such a long time, but they have not answered? Yeah, times and seasons have changed in such a way that God gets a back seat. But we, the people of God, we are His children. And Jesus said, I no longer call you servants, but I'm calling you friend. Because a servant doesn't know what the master is doing. They're not clued in. They don't have the mind and the heart of the master. They don't know what's going on, but a friend does. And so He said, I've called you friend. Are you a friend of the Lord today? Ask yourself the question. Because if you say yes, but you're not obedient to Him, Jesus' own words would condemn you, because Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And certainly a friend would love a friend. We are chosen for His purpose, saints of God. We are chosen. And for those of you who are trying to make up your mind about going deeper in God, or those who are trying to make up their minds to come and serve the Lord, God has designed each and every one of us for a purpose, His purpose. Remember, God created all of this. The earth wasn't here until He created it. And the Bible says there was nothing but darkness. But God created. He spoke land into place, into being, in space. And he began to create the earth so that it would be able to have life on it. And then he created all life forms and created man and gave man dominion over the earth. But Jesus says, you didn't choose me, I chose you. Because as God, it is his plan for us that we prosper. And it is his plan for us that we take dominion over this earth. That means everything that is good and prosperous should be yours. And there's no reason why it shouldn't be. But the devil wants to derail all the plans that God has made and designed for each of our lives. Now, it must be noted here that the words chosen and appointed must be viewed as one linked to the other. Now, this statement is significant in that it identifies two main points here that I want to share with you. Two main points, all right? Number one, by simply choosing us, God changed our destiny. So whatever my life was destined for, now it's been changed by a power that is superior to mine. That's what I want in my life, and that's what you should want in your life. The fact that he has chosen us means that he has destined us for something. And isn't that wonderful? Because God sees your now, he understands your past, but he sees our future. And I want to know what that future is for my life, don't you? So by simply choosing us, God changes our destiny. I want you to know that when we put ourselves in a position where we're following his steps, we become a friend of God, because servants don't know where he's going. Servants are told what to do, but we know what he wants because we are following him. And wherever he goes, we go. Oftentimes, Jesus would give a parable and he would talk about the master or the king that was going on a long journey, but his servants stayed back. The friends would no doubt go with the master, but the servants, they're always staying back. But you and I, we are his friends, we're his children, and so we're following him, but are we following in his footsteps? Then number two, in order for us to fulfill our destiny, God has empowered us to act on his behalf, effectively, in other words, making us his ambassadors. We are his ambassadors. So number one, we're chosen and appointed, right? So number one, God changes our destiny because of our chosen and appointed status. And number two, we become his ambassadors. Can I tell you something? We are his friends, not servants. We are his friends, not servants. You should just take time right now to just glorify God and just thank God for that, that you are a friend. I know sometimes we're so messed up, right? We make so many mistakes. But that's the wonderful thing about the friendship between God and us, is grace covers us so that no matter where we are, just as long as we have this understanding, this desire in our hearts to always get back up again if we've fallen and to continue to follow in his footsteps. There's just a wonderful love of the Lord that I just see in this grace that we have in these last days. And to be honest with you, I'm so glad I serve a God that is merciful and kind. Not the kind of gods that I see people serving that they better do, you know, 15 things here or 30 things there, and they have to live their lives and make sure they never make a mistake or they're just going to hell. But our God says, not only am I going to help you to do right, I'm going to be in you and I'm going to help you. That's why you need the Holy Ghost. Don't ever stop praying for the Holy Ghost. Those of you who've been baptized in Jesus' name and you're seeking, you seek the Lord until he is found in you, when you can feel that presence of God come over you and you begin to speak in tongues. And you don't have to be in church to receive the Holy Ghost. You can be at home to receive the Holy Ghost. There are people listening right here online, right in our church, that's received the Holy Ghost in their own homes. I've known people that got the Holy Ghost on the job. I've known people that got the Holy Ghost on the bus. That's right. Because they just prayed and they were just in a place in their minds and in their hearts where God just poured out his spirit and they became a witness to others. Amen. So we are friends, not servants. In John chapter 15, it talks about You know, the Lord saying, you're no longer servants, you're my friend. But when I thought about that word friend, and I looked that up in the Greek, that word friend means dear friend. Amen. In the Greek, the word is philos, and it means dear friend. The Lord tried to correct the perception of his disciples, in other words. They saw him as Lord and Master, and so we should. He is still Lord and Master, and we should never lose respect. You know, sometimes we call ourselves friends to others, but we don't respect them, right? We don't respect their decisions. Oftentimes, we try to browbeat somebody until they see things our way. If they don't see things our way, we get all angry at them. That's not friendship. I don't know what that is. That's just manipulation. You really and truly are not a friend. And if you have friends like that, they're not your friend. They're manipulators. But a friend is different. A friend will listen, and a friend will try to figure out ways to correct you when you're wrong, but in a way, because they understand your nature, because they took time to, they will find a way to help you to see right. And if you're a true friend, you will look carefully at what they're doing or saying, and you might even find out that you're wrong simply because you're willing to listen. But when you're in a position, if you find yourself consistently trying to change somebody's mind, and even if they're doing wrong, but you're just beating up on them, what you're trying to do is to manipulate someone, and that's not a good thing. Parents sometimes try to manipulate their children instead of trying to teach their children so that they can understand. And this way, they're not just doing what you're telling them, but they're learning how to develop some really great decision-making skills so that when you're not around, they can rightly divine what is right from wrong. So there's a difference between a friend and a manipulator. Jesus is not a manipulator. As great as he is as God, he will never force you and I to do anything. It has to be our decision. And so he's placed apostles and prophets and pastors and evangelists and teachers in the body to teach. This way we are learning, we're grounded in the truth so that we can make righteous decisions. That's right. I remember one person saying to me one time, actually they didn't say it directly to me, they said it to someone else. They thought I didn't care because I didn't beat up on them. And I didn't chase them down and tell them, you know, you better do this or else. And because I didn't do that, they thought I didn't care. Well, you know what? That's not what a pastor's job is. A pastor's job is to preach and to teach the word, and the Holy Ghost convicts you. And when you're doing wrong, then, you know, you feel that you're doing wrong, and the Spirit of God gives you an opportunity to change through the taught word, the preached word. And sometimes the Holy Ghost speaks to you directly. But it is for us to make the decision. He never tries to manipulate you. And I love that about the Lord. So we're friends. We're not servants. And so these disciples, they didn't understand where Jesus was coming from. And so he taught them. He let them follow him, and they walked in his footsteps. How do you see yourself today? A friend or a servant? A dear friend or a servant? You know, I read a newspaper article, and it was really interesting. It was about a competition that was held to find out how people would describe friendship. And one person described friendship in this way, and this was the winning answer. A friend is someone who's walking in when everyone else is walking out. Can you imagine that? You and I have a friend that will do that. A friend who will stick closer than a brother. Amen. The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 20, surely Jesus said to his disciples, I am with you always to the very end of the age. And so a friend, not a servant, is someone who's walking in when everyone else is walking out. I love the Lord for that, because when people walk out on you, it cuts you. It hurts you. But if you've got a friend in Jesus, no matter what happens around you, you can know assuredly, without question, that he is not walking out. He's waiting patiently for everything to calm down and for you and I to come to him. You ought to just take a little time right now and just close your eyes real tight and say, thank you, Jesus. I love you for being my friend. Thank you so much. Are you feeling the presence of God like I'm feeling him? I am so grateful, because if it had not been for this man called Jesus, forever my soul would be lost. My soul would be lost. But you know what? Being a friend is one thing, but there are some responsibilities of friendship. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7 begins, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ. It's obvious that careful planning and thought went into our individual lives before we were born. God said, I know the thoughts that I have towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts that are of peace and not of evil, that you might have an expected end. There's something about the planning of God that brings everything that God does down to you and I. Remember, long before the world was populated, God gave his full focus to two individuals in the Garden of Eden. And the fact that the world is populated by billions of people doesn't change God's approach. It's still about you. It's still about you. And he cares about what's happening in your life. He cares about what's going on in your situation, whatever circumstances that you're in right now that might bring consternation and fear and worry in your life. God is there. He cares, and he's waiting to hear your voice calling out to him. And so the Bible says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. He came and died, shed his blood through Jesus Christ for your sins, for your sins. Can you imagine? What a love of God. One songwriter says, the love of God so rich and pure, so measureless and strong, it shall forever more endure. And the saints and angels, this is what we sing. Amen. And so God took the time to think about you. He took the time to plan for your life. Satan wants to take away those plans. He wants you to not see God, but to see something else. But I would love to encourage you today to turn your eyes upon Jesus and to look full in his wonderful face. The songwriter says, the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace. He loves you so much. Remember, he created the universe. He created even the devil and his minions before Satan was cast out of heaven. He was a good being. And God created everything so that he, God, could interact with all the creation of his hands. And now the devil, because of jealousy of God, he wants to destroy those plans that God had. I would encourage you today to decide to stay with Jesus, to decide to say yes, and to force yourself and to bring yourself to that place where you are focused on him every single day. In our text, Jesus said, you have not chosen me. He says, I have chosen you, and that your fruit should remain. Can I tell you something? That word remain there, it means endure, prosper, to preserve. That whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. That word remain means endure, prosper, and preserve. God is in the enduring business. He wants to help you endure. He's in the business of prospering. That is to make sure you're prospering. And he's in the business of ensuring that you are preserved. You're not alone. Walk in his footsteps. Because can I tell you, a walk with God today will ensure your future tomorrow. A walk with God today will ensure that your future is brighter than what it is right now. And so we are preservers of the kingdom of God, not destroyers of it, because our fruit will remain. We are enduring in the spiritual things in our walk with God, prospering in the blessings that God has given to us. And we are preservers of the kingdom of God. Preservers of the kingdom of God. I want to share some things before we close. Number one, stay connected to God. We need to be united to the vine. John chapter 15 and verses 5 through 7. Let me read that for you. I'm putting the scriptures up there for you to write it down. Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, Jesus said, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. The devil wants us to, do less of church, do less of prayer, and do less of commitment to God, because he knows in us doing that, we will be weakened and we will not be connected to the vine like we ought to be. And sometimes, quite frankly, we're so disconnected that we are nothing what Jesus is describing here. He said, I am the vine and you are the branches. Y'all know if you cut a branch off a tree, the branch is going to die. It needs to stay connected to the tree so that whatever nutrients is coming up from the roots through the that particular tree, it will spread to every branch. And so we need to stay connected. And he says, you will bear much fruit. It's not just fruit in that you're going to be prosperous with a good job and the ability to pay your bills and all of that, but you're going to be prosperous in the things of the kingdom. All the other stuff comes, that's just icing on the cake, you know, that's just icing. But the blessing is to be connected to God so that you can have a long and prosperous life. The Bible tells us that we will live long and prosperous if we are obedient to the things that God says we are supposed to be. I want to live long. I don't know about you. And I don't just want to live long. I want to live long and healthy. And I don't just want to live long and healthy. Amen. I want to live long, healthy, and I want to be able to prosper in the things that God wants me to prosper in so that I can build his kingdom. You know, when you build his kingdom, he blesses you so much that that blessing is so great that your kingdom, your own personal life, in other words, is so blessed that you have so much to give to others. That's how God wants it to be, that we're the givers and not the takers, the head and not the tail. Amen. We are the blessers, and not necessarily that we don't want to be blessed, but we're not looking for a blessing because we're so blessed with so much abundance that it's the easiest thing for us to give to everyone that is in need. Isn't that a wonderful thing for you to want to desire for your life? Well, it comes with staying connected to the Lord. Then the next thing is we need to bring forth fruit. That means we're workers in the kingdom, not idlers. John chapter 6 and verse 27 says, do not work for food that spoils. It says, don't work for food that spoils. We're putting so much effort into things that's going to pass away. And the things that matter to our hereafter are souls that will be so rich and prosperous in the hereafter, because everyone that's born dies. And we don't know when that day is coming when we will pass away from this scene. So what does your planning look like? Are you really following in his footsteps? Because if you are, you're going to work on the things of the kingdom. Let me put those two scriptures up there again for you. Write them down. Amen. John chapter 6 and verse 27, and I'm going to read Ecclesiastes 9 and verse 10 for you. But John 6 and 27 says, do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life. In other words, there are things that are spiritual food. And it's not just eating the word of God, but it's being obedient to the word of God and doing what God says we are supposed to do. In our society, we're supposed to be changers of society, not that the society should be changers of the church. Churches are so trying to be so relevant in the society nowadays that they're changing everything so that they can make people feel comfortable coming into the church. And while they're on the right track, they're not really doing it the right way. Let me explain what I'm talking about so you'll understand what I mean. Relevance doesn't mean compromise. Relevance means that you don't judge the people in the world. That's the biggest problem with the church. They're so used to churches that when they come in off the street, people look them up and down. People judge them before even having a conversation with them. And how do you judge? The way you look at people, they can see you looking at them in a certain way. You put up that wall, they already know you don't want to talk to them by the way you present yourself to them, the way you walk past them, the way you grab their hand to shake it when they stick it out because they're trying to be friendly. And when you just grab their hand and just grab it for a little second and release it and you just want to walk away, oh, they see it. Oh yeah, that's what church has become. But can I tell you this? Church is more relevant when they walk in and they see the love of Jesus. Isn't that what the Lord says? Let's go back to word now. Let's go back to the word. Jesus says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another. So when they come into the church house, when they come to the church picnic, when they walk into that Bible study, that small group, and they see this abundance of love, the way you treat one another, the way after they've been around us for a while, they see that no matter what goes down, when a relationship goes south, they see our immediate reaction to bring unity back. That's what the world needs to see. Not us trying to become like them, look like them, act like them, cuss like them, so that they can come in and we can tell them, listen, the Lord just loves you no matter what you're doing. Just watch me. I cuss like you. I do whatever you do. I go wherever I want to go, and there's no problem in my life. No. They don't want that. They want a change. People are looking for something different. They're used to that. They're used to that. And it's not working for them. They want a people that's full of the Holy Ghost, loving one another, being what God says, because we're following in his steps and we're walking with him day by day. We're being obedient. There's those scriptures again, staying connected to God, John 15:5-7, workers bring forth fruit. We're not idlers. Amen. We are working in the kingdom. John 6:27, Ecclesiastes 9:10. Let me tell you what that says. It says, whatever your hands find to do, whatever it finds to do, do it with all your might. For in the realm of the dead, where you are going, there is neither working nor planning nor knowledge nor wisdom. When you're in the grave, that's it, honey. That's it. That's right. You know, I watched something on YouTube a few years ago. I was just mesmerized by it. A man made it rich, by being very prosperous, became very rich. His dad always wanted a BMW. Some of y'all probably saw the video. And his dad wanted a BMW, but he never had an opportunity to buy this BMW for his dad. And he was rich when his dad was alive, but he never took the time to even say, hey, dad, let me do this for you or that for you. But when his dad died, you know what this lunatic did? He bought a brand new BMW, put his dad in it, dug a hole, and this BMW became the coffin. And I watched them put this man dead in the seat of a BMW, and they began to lower the thing and bury the man in the hole. Some of us, we don't even care about one another in this life. Amen. I remember somebody saying to me concerning some folk that had mistreated them, when I die, I don't even want them at my funeral. We should never live our lives like that. Can I tell you? You can hurt people so much. Make it right. And treat each other right. That father should have gotten a BMW, a Benz. In fact, if the man was saved, the best thing he could have given his dad was an invitation to walk with the Lord. Isn't that something? So here is the Bible telling us that we should do whatever our hands find to do while we are alive. That is to work for the Lord. Do the right things in the kingdom. Love one another. Work in the kingdom so that we can touch lives out there. You know why the work of the kingdom is so important? It's not just so that we can build up our local church alone. We want to build that the powerhouse of the local church. We want the miracles and the signs and wonders to operate in the local church. But it's so that we can go out there and reach people. Reach people. We've got almost 8 billion people to reach in the world. And we need to start in our own communities and start right here with just a few million in New York State. So we've got a lot of work to do to become strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Isn't that what the song said? God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated. And we will shout it out. There's something about lighting up that darkness through your walking with God, through your exemplification of who Christ is, because you're allowing Christ to shine in your life and to be powerful in you, so that the Bible scripture that says greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world will become fact and truth in your life. And then I remember Jesus said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. asked the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers in his harvest. So while the servants are standing around, waiting to be given something to do, one songwriter says, my house is full, but my field is empty. This is the Lord now that they've penned these lyrics to express to the church. The Lord is saying, my house is full, but my field is empty. Pastor, why don't you give me something to do in the church? Can I tell you something? The church is not where the focus should be, because the pastor can only give so many things to so many people. We've got a whole congregation full of people, and your own families that need Christ, your friends that need Christ, the people on your job that need Christ, the people on the streets and the supermarket when you're on vacation that need Christ. And they need to see your lifestyle. Are you walking in step with the Lord today? Here's the scripture. Ask the Lord of the harvest. Amen. Because the harvest is plentiful, but the Lord says the laborers are few. And these signs shall follow them that believe. The Lord says, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. Look at that. In my name. In my name, he says, they shall cast out devils. There's authority. The only thing that we have is his name that brings authority. You need to begin to speak into your life right now. Hallelujah. I want you to just take a little time right now to speak into your own life. To say, Lord, I take authority over my mind, over my spirit, over my life, and I submit it to you. I don't ever want you to be upset with me, Lord. And so I take authority, take dominion. The Lord gave us dominion over this earth, over ourselves. And if we are giving him dominion over ourselves, then can I tell you something? When we speak in his name, it'll be on his authority and your life will be changed. You want to walk with God? Start by saying, yes, Lord. Let's bow our heads right now. Mighty God, we come to you right now. I thank you for those who have joined us today for this online worship service. We thank you for the songs that have been sung, for the prayers that have been prayed. God, for every word that has been spoken. But now it's a decision-making time. And we're asking you right now, God, to anoint every person that's listening, everyone that joined in, that will join in. Lord, that they will say yes to your will, yes to your way. Lord, I'll obey you today. Help us, God, to make a decision to serve you. There are people, Lord God, that they've been riding the fence on baptism, riding the fence on repentance. Lord, I pray that they would say, God, forgive me of all of my sins, Lord, today. That they will say, Lord, I'm going to get baptized next Sunday. Lord, let them reach out to us and let them say, yes, Lord, so that we can put them down in the waters of baptism. And God, would you begin to just pour out your spirit? Lord, I want the phone calls, the text messages, God. Let people hit me up on Facebook and tell me that I was praying, Pastor, and the Lord filled me with the Holy Ghost. I know it because I began to speak in tongues as the Spirit of God gave me the utterance. God, I pray you would pour out your spirit upon all flesh. And Lord, we will give you praise, glory, and honor. And everybody said in Jesus' name, amen. I hope today's message touched your heart and your mind and your life. Make a decision today, not tomorrow, not next week, but today, to serve the Lord. Call on him while he may be found. I want you to know he is near right now, and all you need to do is say, yes, Lord, yes. Thanks to each and every one of you for joining today. Thank you so much for taking your time to come on, and I pray that everything that was said and done actually made a difference in your life. Until next time, God bless you, and we will see you on Wednesday and certainly in person next Sunday and here online again. God bless you. I love each and every one of you. In Jesus' name, amen.